Hi, my name is Govind Jayaraman, and welcome to Paper Napkin Wisdom. I'm thrilled that you've joined me here today, and this is an enormously personal project for me as I explore some of the major impacts on me through my leadership journey, and I'm really excited to share that journey with all of you. And I'm also deeply touched and honored by the feedback and conversation and dialogue that this podcast has started. So thank you for that. Have you or anyone you know been in a situation where you needed to get someone interested, or better yet, intrigued in what you needed to say to them in a moment or in a flash? Well, if so, that person, or yourself if you were that person, wished you had Sam Horn in your corner. Because Sam is the intrigue expert. She's an amazing author, speaker, communicator, strategist, and coach. But it's beyond that. She deeply cares about helping entrepreneurs and leaders communicate better all the time. I am thrilled. Thrilled is not the right word. I am super excited to be sitting here with Sam. Sam Horn is a woman that I met when I was participating at Leadership Academy, which is an entrepreneurs organization sponsored program. And I was there. Warren Rustand, the great Warren Rustand, is the facilitator of the program and brought Sam in to help us communicate. And Sam, I know I've told you the story, but I went to Leadership Academy thinking, wow, I got into this very prestigious program, which means that I must be a pretty good leader, and I must be a pretty good communicator, and darn it, I'm a great listener, because people tell me that all the time. And within 2 minutes of starting the program there, I learned that I'm barely hanging on as a leader. I didn't listen worth a damn, and holy cow, I certainly wasn't communicating very well. But you gave us some great tips, so I'm honored to call you a mentor. I'm honored to be talking to you today. Welcome to Paper Napkin Wisdom.
Thank you very much.
So, Sam, before we get into your pearl of wisdom that you shared with me, what's the one thing that you want people to know about you?
Wow, interesting. Okay, Govan, if I'm going to distill out of everything I could say about myself, what I really want people to know about me is that it is about 30 years ago, we did an exercise, maybe you've done the exercise as well, is to come up with your mission statement. And we spent several hours, people spend, a couple hours trying to figure out what they're going to watch on Netflix, We don't spend a couple hours on our mission statement, what we want to do with the rest of the life, what we want to stand for, what we don't stand for. And I came up with a mission statement 30 years ago, and I haven't changed a word of it since. And as a writer, I know when you wouldn't change a word, when you wouldn't fiddle with it, that resonates. That's right, right? So here's my mission statement. It is my purpose in life is to make a positive difference for as many people as possible while having a healthy, happy life with friends and family. And I think if anybody knows anything about me, it is how grateful I am for a happy, healthy family and friends, and the light is on in their eyes because they're doing work that matters, that they love, and that really adds value. So hopefully that's what people might know about me.
Well, I mean, I don't think how anybody who has ever met you wouldn't get that, because that's all you are. I mean, you sort of exude that. It's almost like a perfume. It's there all around you. And if you weren't even looking and you were over my shoulder, I know I would feel that presence there. Let me read your paper napkin wisdom, if you don't mind. And I think it's brilliant. If you're not intriguing, you're out of sight, out of mind. Why did you share that with me?
Well, because I'm really I'm on a mission, Govan. I really am on a mission for us all to be more intriguing. And here's the backstory, the origin story to it, and why I feel it's so important personally and professionally. I, you know that I helped start the Maui Writers Conference. And this was 20 years ago, and we gave authors an unprecedented opportunity to jump the chain of command. I mean, you could sit across the table from Ron Howard and pitch your screenplay. You could sit across from the head of Doubleday and pitch your novel. But what we didn't anticipate is all those decision makers started these pitch sessions with one question. Guess what the question was?
What was it?
What's your book about?
What's your book about?
And people go, wah, 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 wah. And Govind, they would talk themselves out of a deal. And I saw people who had poured years into their projects, and they could have been brilliant, and they were never going to see the light of day. They were never going to succeed at the level. And it wasn't because they weren't quality. It was because they weren't compelling. And I looked around me, and I saw adults. I mean, I think when we're kids, we expect that when we get to be adults, self-confidence is just going to show up on the scene, right? We're never going to be self-conscious again. I meet people at YPO, at EO, who are head of multi-million dollar organizations, who hang out in their hotel room when they're at a conference because they're so uncomfortable networking. You know, they can't meet people comfortably. They don't know how to be intriguing where someone wants to be around them. In business, we can have a business we care about that we're doing incredible things for our customers. Yet if we can't get it across to people in an elevator intro that people get it and want it, we're constantly compromising our effectiveness, our success, our relationships. So I've come up with a system on how we can be more intriguing. And when we're intriguing, it's not just a win for us. It's a win for everybody we meet, everyone around us.
So how does that, I mean, it obviously translates and people get the idea of being intriguing in a pitching environment, right? If I'm pitching myself or I'm pitching my product, that's an area where I think people get intrigue really easily. But, you know, why do I need to be intriguing with my wife? Why do I need to be intriguing, you know, with my buddy? We got so much skin in the game. Do I need to be intriguing there?
I'm so glad you asked that because my editor said, you know, Sam, what you're doing is really an updating of Dale Carnegie's How to Make Friends and Influence People. And why I think it's important for us to be intriguing and it's a win for everybody is something that Bette Midler said in the movie Beaches. Did you see the movie Beaches a long time ago by any chance?
Yes, I did.
Okay, there's this great line in that movie and she says, well, enough about me. What do you think about me?
Yeah.
And see, so often, I don't care whether it's about our wife or about our kids or about our employees or about someone we meet at a business event, someone we meet at a trade fair. You know, it's usually me, me, me. Here's what I'm doing. Here's what I think about this. And as Dale Carnegie said, you know, he said this 75 years ago, we can make more friends in 2 months by becoming interested in other people than we can in 2 years by trying to get people interested in us. See, the foundation of being intriguing doesn't mean being larger than life and energetic and extroverted. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about reading the mind of everyone, whether it's our wife or our kids or our employees or potential customers or investors. What do they care about? What is most important to them? What's current for them? What is relevant for them? How can I introduce a conversation in a way that no matter how busy or distracted or preoccupied they are, their eyebrows go up and they go, huh, that's interesting. Tell me more. See, now we have a connection, right? And Govind, aren't we all looking for meaningful connections in this disconnected world? How can we connect with people, talk about things that are mutually beneficial and rewarding? That's really what it means to be intriguing.
Yeah, and I think that's the really big difference between being pitchy and artificial, right? And projecting, hey, this is who I have to be. Here's my Superman cape. Let me sail in and save the day. And what you're talking about, which is the authenticity of this relationship, right? Creating really authentic relationships quickly.
That's exactly what it is. And it is essentially understanding no one ever taught us how to be intriguing. We were taught math, science, history in high school and college and so forth. No one ever taught us about your satisfaction and your success in life is directly proportionate to how intriguing you are. In other words, are you worth people's valuable time and mind? Do they want to be around you? Do they want to do business with you? Do you want to have dinner with you? You know, do you want to spend the evening together, et cetera? So intriguing, it's an art and a science. It's both head and heart. Yep, there are techniques. Here's actually what to say, et cetera. But it's also, as you said, it's founded, much more importantly, in how can we take responsibility for making every conversation with someone a win for both of us.
That's amazing. And the thing I find amazing about what you just said is I think that people often fail to recognize that their failure in an elevator pitch, their failure in that 30 second, we're this instantaneous society where everything's got to come fast. And if it's not coming fast, and if we're not, and we have to be quick at digesting what's interesting and what's not interesting, better yet, what's intriguing. And if we can't connect at from a sincere place with people, fast, quicker than we've ever done before,
that's right.
We're alone.
We're alone. Oh wow! I see. I'm taking notes, Govan. Because here's one of my favorite little success stories, both personally and professionally, and it illustrates exactly what you said. This was at a big conference in Switzerland, and a guy came up to me beforehand, and he said, Sam, I'm going to tell you something I usually don't admit. He said, I run a very successful IT company. He said, I hate networking. He said, I can never explain what I do in a way that people get it. It's so awkward. I just rather avoid it. And so I said, you want to brainstorm right now? And so I said, okay, so tell me what you do that we can see, that we can smell, that we can taste, that we can touch. And he said, Sam, why is that important? And I said, because most of us try and explain how electricity works or how a cell phone works. Trying to explain a complex business is kind of Bette Midler, me, 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 me. We want to switch it to how people experience or benefit from what we do instead of trying to explain what we do. So I'm saying, tell me what you do that I can see. And he starts talking about financial software, credit cards. The light bulb went off, and I said, oh, do you make the software that makes it safe for us to buy things online? He said, yes. I said, now don't say that, because if people say, what do you do? And you say, I make the software that makes it say blah, blah. You know what people say? Oh, they get it, but it's still a one-way conversation. I said, turn it into a three-part question. Do you, a friend or family member, ever buy things online, like on eBay, Travelocity, or Amazon? They may say, well, I hate that stuff, but my wife's on Amazon all the time. She loves the free shipping. Now, connect what you do to what they just said. Oh, I make the software that makes it safe for your wife to buy things online on Amazon. Guess what happens? Their eyebrows go up. Oh, they get it. They relate to it. Now we have something in common. There's a connection. However, here is what makes that story so important, and it goes right back to what you said. He kind of got misty-eyed a little bit, and I said, what's up? He said, I can't wait until I get home tonight. And I said, why? He said, because I can finally explain to my 8-year-old son what I do in a way he gets it. He said, I'm just gone for hours at a time, days at a time. It's been such a disconnect because he's never understood what I did. So you see, we're alone. If we can't get across what we do in a way people relate to it, have some familiarity, we're strangers everywhere we go, our own kids. We're stranger if they don't get it. So it's not just about our work. It's about other things that are important and finding out how it might be relevant to the other person. Then, as you said, instant connection, we're no longer alone.
That's amazing. That's so powerful. I just had a flashback to being in that room with you in D.C. when I first heard that the structure of the conversation. And I'm not trying to make this academic by saying there's a structure to it, but really there is, right? I mean, it's a formula. If you do these things, you'll get these results.
See, Govan, I'm really glad you're bringing this up because, see, it is left and right brain, isn't it? You bet it's a structure. Because, see, if we people may agree with the idea, but then it's like, how do I do it? What do I say? What are the words? And now I'm not talking about a script or a formula. What I am talking about is when we give people a template, number one, never again tell people what you do. That's a lecture. That's a me, elevator speech. Who wants to listen to a speech? So no more I help blank, do blank, so blank, right? That's all Bette Midler, me. No, ask a question that engages the other person. Like, you probably remember the story about Inc. 500. Here's Colleen, Entrepreneur of the Year. What do you do? Wah, wah, wah. 500 of the top entrepreneurs in North America. No one understood. A complete dropped ball, lost opportunity. And furthermore, no one's going to walk up and talk to her afterwards because there's no hook on which to hang a conversation. So essentially, you know, she's talking about medical, and finally it's like, oh, do you run the medical facilities that offer MRIs and CAT scans? Yes. Don't say it. Ask it. Do you know anyone, could be a friend, family member, yourself, who's had an MRI or CAT scan? Oh, yeah, my daughter had one when she hurt her knee. Now we're off and running on a mutually rewarding two-way conversation.
And that's intrigue, right?
That's just one-way intrigue. I mean, we have so many different ways of intriguing people because, once again, as you said, people, I agree with it in theory. Now, how can I do it in practice? How can I do it in an investor meeting? How can I do it around a staff meeting with my employees? How can I do it when I'm speaking at a conference? How can I do it when I, meeting someone out on at the bark park? So it's everywhere with everyone.
And how does this play out for you? In the sense that, what I mean by that is, how has this discovery changed your life?
Huh, interesting. Okay, let me think of all the things I could say. I believe, and I know this is true of you, Govan, life is a blessing, isn't it?
It is.
It is a blessing to be alive, to be healthy. Katherine Graham of the Washington Post said, to do what you love and feel that it matters, how could anything be more fun? The only thing that could be more fun is to do what you love, it matters, and do it with people you enjoy and respect. This whole process and importance of understanding it is our responsibility to be intriguing. There's no such thing as a bad audience. There's no such thing as a cold group, as an unfriendly person. If we meet someone and there's not a connection, it's not their fault. It's our responsibility to frame our conversation and our interaction in a way, even if they're stressed out, even if they're under pressure, even if they're busy, that now they're motivated to want to connect with us. Can I give you a quick example of this?
Yes, please.
Okay. You and I talked one time about not being insular, about deliberately every quarter reaching out, going someplace new, putting ourselves in a new situation so we're constantly expanding our world, right, our horizons. So I love this conference called BIF. It's Business Innovation Factory, and it's up in Providence. It's run by Saul Kaplan. He brings in the top innovation experts from around the world, Tony Hsieh, Zappos, Alan Weber of Fast Company, and so forth. However, Govan, guess who was the most intriguing person at that entire international conference?
Who?
It's this person who walked out. She stood. She towered instead of cowered. She had basketball hands instead of the fig leaf position. And the first words out of her mouth were, "I know what you're thinking. What's a 13-year-old girl going to teach me about innovation?" She said, "Well, if I can have your attention for the next 3 minutes, I'll introduce," and she's off and running. Hey, are you intrigued?
Heck yeah.
And you see how, she took responsibility. She realized that group was thinking, wait a minute, I run a multi-billion-dollar organization and a 13-year-old girl's going to teach me about something intriguing? So, that is a technique we can use when we anticipate a no, when we know people are going to resist, we say it up front, because if we don't say it, they're not listening. They're waiting for us to stop talking so they can tell us why this won't work, or they're already checking email, right?
Yeah. And that's so powerful. Sam, you gave me so much, you're blowing my mind, because it just in that last little piece, you talked about, you know, that it's our responsibility in the communication to be intriguing, to create that bilateral communication. So it's not just about listening. And then you went right through it and showed an example of how anybody can do that in any situation by referencing that 13-year-old girl in front of the BIF conference. I think, you know, in digesting all of this, really it just comes down to, and this happened to me today. This happened to me today. I'm getting caught in my own trap. It's so fun to have this conversation today, because today I gave someone a rote answer about a question. And this person knows me well enough to push me back. And he pushed back, and I gave him a much more sincere and passionate answer, which evoked an emotional response in myself, but also the other two people on the call. And just reminding myself now that that was a point of intrigue. I went from pitching to being intriguing.
Yes. It is the... You brought up, too, that people in this sped-up world where everyone's suffering from infobesity, right?
Yeah, that's a great word.
You know, so it's like you've got seconds. You know, Carrie Fisher said instant gratification takes so long. So we've got seconds to prove that we're worth, you know, their mind and time, or else we're out of sight, out of mind. So here's a great story about an EO-er out of Silicon Valley who had an opportunity to pitch the CTO of the London Olympics. And I said, Mike, how much time do you have? And he said, I have an hour. I said, Mike, you don't have an hour. I said, do you know, if you want to win buy-in, do you know what the first words out of your mouth are going to be? I can only imagine how busy you are. You're 212 days out from the London Olympics. I know we have an hour scheduled for this. I have distilled my comments into 10 minutes. At the end of that 10 minutes, if you want to continue the conversation, I welcome it. If you have a pressing priority that you need to take care of, you'll have our information. You're welcome to get back in touch when you want to. Do you see the quickest way to be intriguing is to always mention time up front? I know you're busy, and may I have 2 minutes of your time? I know you're busy, and we've got this scheduled for half an hour. I've distilled, condensed, down into 5 minutes. Then... Do you see how that's the quickest way to be intriguing? Because everyone is, from the first moment we open our mouth, is wondering, how long is this going to take? Don't you know how busy I am? I don't have time for this. Do you know how much I have to do? Their mind's going like this. And if we don't address it right up front and pleasantly surprise them by taking less time than they expected, they're already reaching for the smartphone.
Yeah, and the counterpoint to that too, though, Sam, is that even if someone's being authentic about being there, they are busy. They do have other things. So even if they're sincerely 100% present in the room because they're not thinking about how busy they are, acknowledging the fact that they've honored you with their time is powerful.
You're so right. I wrote a book on concentration. It's Concentrate. Stephen Covey said it's the best book he's ever seen on focus. And one of the things we talk about is, it's called the Godfather Plan. Make your mind a deal it can't refuse. And when you give people, as you just said, when you acknowledge that they're busy, so you're honoring their schedule, and when you give them time parameters, people will say, okay, this is going to take 10 minutes. I can give my undivided attention for 10 minutes, and then I'll think about that investor meeting I've got, or then I'll think about that. So that's another benefit of putting a time parameter around your request for someone's time or attention, because they can mentally agree to it and then not be distracted, you know, with all those unanswered questions in their mind.
That's fantastic. Well, in honoring the time parameters, our time today is up. But, Sam, I'm hoping I can pull you back in again sometime and we can continue this conversation.
You know, I would love to, because, you know, one of the things we can talk about is I have a little intriguing quiz, okay? And we can take this in the privacy of our home, Govan.
That's great.
And we can really do a self-assessment. about, am I doing what I can to make myself an intriguing boss, an intriguing mom, an intriguing date, you know, an intriguing speaker, an intriguing author, so that I'm doing my half to make it worth people's valuable time and mind to spend it with me.
That's great. That's great. I can't wait to continue this conversation.
Excellent.
Is it any surprise to you that more than 500,000 people worldwide have listened to her speak? Can you even conceive for a moment that she's literally helped hundreds and hundreds of people through her Maori Writers Conference actually get into publishing, get into getting their book published? Incredible, incredibly impactful woman. Really, really grateful to have had her here. Thank you, Sam. And that brings me to you. If you have anyone that has been deeply impactful on you, I would love to have that conversation with you. I would love to learn who they are. I would love to bring them onto the podcast. Please reach out to me either at papernapkinwisdom.com or alternatively via Twitter at wisenapkin. Really exciting news for me anyway is that iTunes has now approved our podcast. So you can actually subscribe to Paper Napkin Wisdom on iTunes. Find us there by simply searching Paper Napkin Wisdom. My name is Govind Jayaraman. Thank you so much for joining me here today.